Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Because you are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. Oh, you're perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways.
It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you.
You are perfect in all.
Adam, I appreciate you getting me to cry before I preach. Appreciate that, brother. I'm such a blessed man to have had a father like I had. He's been with the Lord for 2 years now, and sometimes it's hard to believe. But I know that God has certainly used my dad. Wasn't a perfect dad, but I tell you, he lived what he preached. I think the only time I ever saw Dad relax, nobody else would see this but Dad, is he would, when it's just a family home, you know, Dad was old school. He's always shirt and tie and suit most of the time. Even when he went out visiting, he would wear a tie. Later in life, finally, he loosened up a little bit. Every now and then, he would wear a jacket without a tie, which shocked me a few times that he actually did that. But when he was at home, he would wear this old raggedy white T-shirt and shorts. Nobody else ever saw Dad like that except us. But in fact, when he would come and up here when to stay in Salem, he wanted to stay at a hotel most of the time because he wanted to be able to walk around and look like, you know, in his underwear and just in T-shirt and just relax, not have to worry about anybody seeing him. But well, one thing's for sure, Dad always, always was praying for me, praying for my family, praying for my sister and her family. And when I say pray, Dad didn't just nonchalantly just pray for 5 or 10 minutes. Every single morning, and I can prove it to you, I could show you some pictures of after Dad had passed away, he had this huge table and he had business cards and people's names and all over the place. I mean, of course, he was old school. He didn't put anything on the computer, but he had everything laid out. And I'm not lying, every single morning, hour and a half, 2 hours, just praying. Every single morning, praying for those individuals, not counting the time that he would pray throughout the day. But every morning he'd get up and pray for these people, and he would pray for certain things. I tell you, there are times I've vented to my dad, and I shared with my dad. I said, Dad, you know, I need you to help me pray about this. And every time Dad would pray, he says, you're going to get an answer soon. It depends on what it was. And every time I got an answer, every time God showed me that that he was in tune with what Dad had to say. As my brother just mentioned, I know some people have never had the opportunity to grow up with a good dad or somebody who was there for you. And I know we can get a very distorted view of what a good father looks like. We may not know what a good father looks like because we didn't grow up with what we consider a good father. Maybe some people even here today grew up with an abusive father or someone who wasn't present in your life. One thing's for sure, God is the perfect father. And he wants to love on you and be there for you every single moment of your life. I love what one of my friends put up all throughout his house. Pray about everything, worry about nothing. That's biblical. And sometimes we think, well, I'm not going to bother God with the small stuff. You'd be amazed how God intervenes in the small stuff. Like a good, good father, he cares about every single part of your life. We're going to talk about a good father today. Luke chapter 15. This is a very familiar text. And when we look at Luke 15, we most of the time we see this parable referred to as the prodigal son. In fact, in chapter 14, there's three different parables, three different things that Jesus is sharing with us. He talks about the lost sheep, and then he talks about the lost coin, and then he talks about the lost son. And a lot of times when we read this parable, we think of, we call it the parable of the prodigal son. We focus on the son so much, that the son going off and doing his thing and coming back, and we focus on it. But really, do you realize the word father is mentioned more than son? I believe with all my heart, and I agree with David Jeremiah. He said this one time. He says, this is really, in essence, a story about the father. Because I think a lot of us can relate to the son. But the question is, I'm asking dads today, can you relate to the father? Because this, even though this was an earthly father, it gives us a picture of what our father is like in heaven. In Luke chapter 15, look with me in verse 11. It says, Jesus continued and he shared. This is the third story that he's sharing with these people. He says, he continued and says, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. What's interesting about this story, now keep in mind, especially in this particular, in Jewish culture, this was a big deal. Very similar to Western culture in some respects, but a little different. When you are the firstborn son, which is the older brother, which we'll talk about in just a moment, basically, you're equal to the father. You get the majority of the inheritance. You kind of take over as CEO of the estate. But still, there's a second son, a younger son. There is still a certain amount of the estate that he will receive as well. But you do not receive your part until the father has died. Now, that makes sense to us, doesn't it? It's amazing to me. Let me just pause for a second. It's amazing to me, over the years, I've done a lot of funerals. A lot of funerals. And I remember, of course, the first year I was here, it just seemed like there was a whole lot of people that went to be with the Lord that first year I was here. In fact, I remember vividly having four funerals in 1 week. Two in 1 day. And it's interesting, every situation is different, but it's interesting to me how, without even trying, people sometimes will suck you into family disputes about what's theirs. And I make it a rule of thumb, I am not getting involved in family disputes over who gets what. Don't even get me involved. I'm not going there. But it's amazing to me how many people in that family will fuss and fight over what's theirs. I mean, they didn't even had the funeral yet. And they're already talking about, well, I'm going to get that, and I'm going to get that, and that person, my sister, my brother, he better not, or she better not. That's mine. Mom says that's mine. Dad says that's mine. Isn't it amazing how many times, now y'all know what I'm talking about. You probably somebody in your family, perhaps you've experienced that kind of thing. But here, we look at this text and it's very similar. The younger son says, I want my inheritance now. You know what he was saying in essence? Dad, I wish you were dead. Because if you were gone, I could have what, but would you please, would you just go ahead and give me what I want? Let me do with it what I please. The main point I want you to see here in this text is a good father. Now look at the father, because the father, for whatever reason, goes right ahead and gives the son, the younger son, his inheritance. I believe number one, you notice a good father loves his children no matter how badly they treat him. A good father loves his children no matter how badly they treat him. It's interesting, this text, as I was going through this text this week, it's interesting to see the characteristics of this father. He didn't have to do this, did he? He didn't have to do this. He would have done what a lot of us would have done. He says, no, you wait. I don't know how I would have reacted with something like this, but can you imagine the verbal abuse this father went through? The son had reached an age where he was considered an adult. He can be out on his own. And he says, Dad, I want my stuff now. I'm out of here. Dads, or moms for that matter, can you ever remember your children saying something like this? Mom, Dad, I hate you. Now, I'm not asking you to raise your hand if you ever heard those words, because one thing's for sure, if you've ever heard those words, they hurt, don't they? Is it possible that you know of a dad or mom that's heard words like, "I wish you would just die"? You say, how in the world can anybody get to that point where they could say such a thing as that? I don't know how we as individuals can get or be that angry. I suspect that a lot of times parents hear those words during the teenage years. Amen? I hate you. And you know what y'all make me think as a parent? Somebody get a priest. We need an exorcism in here. No, you don't need a priest. I'm just, you know. But you're like, I cannot believe my child, who I have raised, changed their diapers, fed them, clothed them, loved them, nurtured them, could actually get so mad at me that they would say, I hate you. One thing I do know for sure, though, they don't really hate you. They just don't like what you have to say. They do not agree with your choices, and they think your choices stink. So out of anger, they will say things like this. Would you imagine how this father felt? But he loved his son anyway. Here's another thing I want you to understand that I think is important to understand in parenting, because I get it wrong all the time. I tell you, all three of my kids are different in the way one thing works with one don't work with the other. And sometimes I just feel like nothing works. You ever get like that? You just feel like nothing you say, nothing you do is just working? And you get frustrated. And what happens when your child reaches a certain age, you go from being a parent to an advisor. That's hard. It's hard. And I look back and, the 19 years that God's allowed me to be a father, I look back and I wish that I could go back and say and do things differently. Don't you guys? And there are times when you just feel like you just are not getting it. And then when you have moments like this, where that one thing that your child, it may not be that harsh, but that one thing your child says to you that hurts you so deeply that they will never understand. But yet, despite that pain, you still love them, don't you? We look at this text and he goes on to say, Jesus was sharing, he says, not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for the distant country. There he squandered his wealth to wild living. I love how that translation puts that out there. It says, after he spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his field to feed pigs. Now, a Jewish boy feeding pigs, that's a big deal. That's a low. He had reached rock bottom, folks. Said he longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. And when he came to his senses, I love that too, when he finally came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starved to death. I will set out and go to my father and say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up, went to his father. But while he was still, catch this, a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. And he ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. Now keep in mind, this son had been gone for a long time. He had foolishly squandered his money. He was there feeding pigs. That was his job. He came to his senses. He's coming home. He's on his way home. And instead of the father sitting in his chair, perhaps on a porch, watching the son come, he could have just sat there and said, you're finally home, huh? Spent all your money, huh? I told you so. It's not what the father did he? He got up, saw his son way out in the field from a distance. And catch this, the son is rehearsing what he's going to say to the father. And the father takes off running. Not walking fast, running to his son. And before the son can even get the first word out, he grabs his son, he embraces him, and he kisses him on his neck. Can you imagine the stench? But the father didn't care. He wasn't waiting for an explanation. He didn't give the son a chance to explain. He was just glad to see his son. You see, a good father longs for a close relationship with his children, and he's also quick to forgive. I tell you, sometimes I don't know how to communicate this with my kids. Sometimes I really stink at this. I'm really not good at communicating like I should, and sometimes I was sharing with somebody this morning, by nature, I'm an introvert, which is a miracle that I'm doing what I'm doing, because this is against the grain for me. So sometimes it's really, really hard for me personally in my relationships to share how I feel, but I tell you, I long every day to make a difference in my life. I want my kids to love me. I don't want to disappoint my kids. I want them to know how deeply I care, how I want to hear about what's going on in their life. Unfortunately, sometimes Amy knows more than I do, but I long for that. I long for my kids to feel the freedom to just talk to me. I know now Caitlin's older, but I miss those days when she would jump in my lap in the recliner. It didn't matter what we were watching. She just wanted to hang out with Dad. I miss those days when it was cool to be hanging out with Dad. I miss those days. Caitlin got a little bit older, and we used to watch CSI together. It was just our routine. It's just, when, you know, certain time. And, of course, she got older. She got to stay up a little bit later, so we watched CSI together. And we would discuss what happened. I miss those moments. They change, don't they? You know, not that we don't get together and do it. It's just the way we get together is just different. And Caitlin probably doesn't know this, and I'm not trying to get y'all to feel sorry for me by any means, but I tell you, it is totally different when your kid goes off to college, isn't it? It is so depressing to walk by your child's room and see it empty. I try not to share that because I don't want to get Amy upset when I share it, so I don't share it, but it does. It just changes so much. You know, Kendall, life's a party, as I've heard you've heard me say so many times before, but she's my encouraging one. She's the one that's always senses, Dad, what's wrong? You know, and she always had that personal discernment. And Kayla's my fun buddy. I mean, we can hang out. That's one of the things I need to do more of. I know my dad and I talked about this late in life. You know, those moments that we had together. You know, I know Christians say billiards, but we went and shot pool together on a regular basis. That was our time. We'd fish together from time to time and do things like that. But, man, it's just so important. And I realize this, and even right now as I'm preaching to you, I realize how that I need to do more. I long for a relationship, a close, intimate relationship with my kids on a daily basis. But listen, the dad was so happy, wasn't he? He was so happy to see his son. He was so filled with joy to see him once again, and he embraces him and kisses him on the neck, and he And he just welcomes him home. And we go into the next part of this text. This is the son said to him, Father, I've sinned. Finally, he's beginning to give his speech. He says, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, quick, interrupts him, quick, bring the best robe, put it on him. Put a ring on his finger, sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. All the father wanted to do was to take that moment to celebrate that his son was finally home. You listen, number three, a good father loves his children unconditionally. No matter what they do, no matter what they say, no matter how upset you get with your kids, a good father, a good mother is going to love their children unconditionally. I tell you, there are things, right? There are things that our kids, there are choices that our kids make that just really upset us, right? There are things that our kids say, things that our kids do that really upset us. But no matter what they do, they need to know that we love them unconditionally. That's what our Heavenly Father is always about when it comes to us. He loves us no matter what we do. And he's a lot better at it than we are, guys, isn't he? I mean, think about it. I'm so glad. I heard one of my friends say recently, I'm so glad that I'm not Jesus. Because if I was Jesus, there's a whole lot of people that wouldn't be around. If I was Jesus, I would lose my patience. If I was Jesus, there'd be a whole lot of people that would be getting exactly what they deserve. But you see, that's not Jesus. He's not about making life difficult for us. He's not about bringing harm to us. Jesus is crazy about us, and he loves us unconditionally. You can't ever tell me that God doesn't love us. He settled his love on the cross. He wasn't just nailed to a cross. He was brutally beaten, spit upon, ridiculed. He was almost to the point of death before they nailed him to the cross. And he could look all around him and see people in their hate-filled faces. And he could look at that hatred in their eyes. And he could look right into their faces and says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I don't know about you, but when somebody hates me, and I know they hate me, it's sure hard to even like them. It's sure hard to even care one thing about them. Amen? But Jesus looks at them with compassion. He looks at them, and he forgives them. He loves us so much that he gave himself up. He poured his life into ours and gave his life for us. And 3 days later when he rose from the dead, it was not about getting even, was it? It was about bringing salvation to even those who crucified him. Remember Paul, or once Saul? He was a brutal, violent, awful, hateful person. And Jesus does something that blows all of our minds. He did not kill Paul. Paul deserved it. He could have, on the road to Damascus, God just could have said, okay, Paul, Saul, you've done enough. You're gone. No, that's not, what did he do? He confronts Saul. He says, Saul, why do you persecute me? Paul comes to realization what he has done. He confesses his sin. Jesus not only forgives Paul, but he now commissions him to plant churches all over Asia Minor. You see, God loves us so much that he can take our hateful black hearts and turn it into something beautiful. A good father loves his children so much that he's trying to figure out how to help them become a better person. You parents, you guys know, fathers, you know, you want the best. You want your kids to do better than you. Amen? You want your kids to excel you in life. You want your kids not to make the same mistakes you made growing up. There are so many times, kids, sometimes they'll say, "You just don't want me to have fun. Why are you telling me? What are you doing? Why are you doing this?" Because we remember when we were your age that we made a certain mistake and we were heading down the road to that mistake. And what we're trying to do is to head it off before you get there. And I know, kids, I know you don't understand that. But we say no sometimes because we love you and we don't want you to go through the unnecessary hurts that life brings. But one thing's for sure, just like this good father, he had to let his son go, didn't he? He had to. He didn't want his son to go. He didn't have to give his son his inheritance. But the son had reached the age where he can make decisions on his own. So what does the good father do? He lets the son make mistakes. That's hard, isn't it? I believe that's probably the hardest part of being a parent, is knowing that your kids are making mistakes. Bad choices, but you have to let them make bad choices. And you just pray, "God, please, please help them to come out of this okay." Amen? That's the hardest thing. I don't know about y'all, but that's the hardest thing. It is so hard to let go, isn't it? It is so hard. Because you want to tell your kid to do this, 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 and this, and don't skip this. But you know what they do? They skip this, 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 and they do this, and they think they got all the answers. And I know that's frustrating. But parents, listen, we've got to let them make bad choices. I don't like it either. I hate it. I despise the fact that I've got to let them make bad choices. But just like the good father, he knew his son was headed to disaster. But I can imagine he prayed every day, "God, spare his life. God, spare his life. God, spare his life. God, bring him back to me. Help him to come to his senses." And one day he did, in a pig farm. God answered that prayer. The father knew he answered that prayer. He saw his son out in the distance. And he was ready to greet. And the father didn't say anything. Not that is recorded anything. Like, "I told you so," did he? He didn't have to. He knew his son had learned the hard way. And that everything that he learned in that bad choice that he made, everything that God had taught him in those bad choices, was punishment enough. Because he knew that when the son was coming, he was going to have to swallow his pride. And he had already repented before he said a word. Meanwhile, what happened? The older son was in the field. And when he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and he asked him, "What's going on? Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed a fatted calf because he has him back safe and sound." So the older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him, but he answered his father, "Look, all these years I have been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fatted calf for him? Really, Dad?" And the father said, "My son, you're always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because the brother, this brother of yours, was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. You see, the older brother was angry because, wait a minute, I haven't done anything wrong, Dad. I stuck it out with you. I'm here for you, Dad, and I've never disobeyed you. And you're having a party for my little brother? Really? You see, a good father certainly rewards obedience. But that does not mean disobedience brings an end to love and grace. There is benefits to being obedient. Amen? There is so much pain and suffering that you do not have to go through if you're just obedient. And I believe with all my heart, those of you parents here today, things that you have done, choices you have made that your parents says don't do it, I bet you, including me, can think back, oh Lord, if I could just go back and unchoose that bad choice. Right? There are things we wish we could go back and change. There's some things we wish we could go back. Knowing what we know now, if we could only have an opportunity to make that choice again, I would have chosen something differently. Because we know the principle, don't we? Whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also what? Reap. You sow to the flesh, you'll reap what? Corruption. You wonder why sometimes things don't go so well in life? Could it be that in the past you sowed to the flesh? Is God forgiving you? Absolutely. Does God love you? Absolutely. Is God's grace sufficient? Absolutely. But just think about all those things you could have enjoyed in this life if you had just been obedient. Amen? So it wasn't a question about whether that older son did the right thing. The older son did the right thing. He was obedient, but in his obedience, he became a little legalistic, didn't he? He wanted the worst to happen to his younger brother. He was shocked to discover that Dad was throwing a party for him. But the principle of being a good father, being a good parent, is that you're still going to love them. And you're still going to be gracious to them. And you're still going to tend to give them things that they do not deserve. Amen? Because why? You're a good father. You're a good mother. You love them unconditionally. You love them with all your heart. God gave them to us to love like He loves us. We've got the perfect Father. It demonstrates what fatherhood should look like. The perfect father. Are we going to be perfect? Absolutely not. But I think we need to strive with all our hearts, mind, soul, and strength to be the father God wants us to be. I say that this morning, and I'm preaching to me too. I want to be a better father. I want to be a father like my heavenly Father. And that means grace, love, and truth. Speak the truth to your kids. Warn your kids. But don't smother them. Because when you smother them, they're still going to make bad choices. I know, believe me. You can't smother them. You can't be a helicopter parent. You've got to. Now listen, don't get me wrong. When they're young and they're living in your household, you better know what's going on in their life. You better monitor their social media. You better have an app to find out where they're at. If they live under your house and you're paying the bills, you better be a good parent and find out what's going on. The things you can do, I'm not saying you shouldn't do those. Those things you should do, you should be smart about your parenting. But what I am saying, there comes a time in our kids' life that we've got to allow them to make choices on their own. And they're going to make bad choices, and they're going to learn from those choices. Just keep praying that God will protect them, that God will keep them from harm. dangers, temptations. Father, we thank you so much.